In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I welcome you here this morning. We are gathered here for a unique service. As we come together, I invite you first of all to join me in a word of prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you speak to us through your word, telling us of a sting, a pain called death. Today we gather feeling the reality of that, feeling the sting as we experience a passing that creates a vacancy in our hearts and in our souls. As we come together in this service, Father, I pray that you will also speak to us through your word, telling us more about what is real, helping us hear that there is a balm for this sting, that there is a redemption from this pain, that there is light that is stronger than this darkness. Not only speak, Father, but help us hear, reminding us of the times that we have known that bear witness to the truth of our Redeemer, the truth of salvation, reminding us of how Alan bore witness to this truth through the way that he lived his life, through the man that he was. As we are gathered here today, Father, bring comfort to our hearts and our souls. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It is a grief-causing event that brings us together this morning. The death of Alan Gene Rimpey. We are here today because he played a role in our lives and has made a lasting mark on us. Whether through his teaching Sunday school or involvement with 4-H or grabbing the rusted white cup to take a drink from the well by the machine shed or walking beside you through the bean fields or slinging bales of hay, or working until all was done and all wagons were full, or his unchanging laughter, or his exclamation, "Jiminy," when unexpected things would happen, like a four-wheeler running into a garage door, or his supervision of your progression through the lawn-mowing rite of passage, making sure that you knew how to mow grass in the correct method around the yard, similar to the mowing of hay goes around the field. In some and in many ways, Alan made our lives better and leaves us a legacy, a life example worthy of following. It is good and right to remember all the ways that we can say that. It is good and right to share those memories with others. And it is good and right to admit that his passing hurts. However, we are here today to do more than reflect and remember. We come together today to call upon the Lord, seeking his aid as we move through this valley of death and grief. It is something that God himself invites us to do, speaking often of his presence with us in hard times, in the Bible. For example, through David, God tells us that he is our shepherd. We shall not want. He makes us lie down in green pastures. He leads us beside quiet waters. He restores our souls. He leads us in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we have no reason to fear any evil, because he is with us. His rod and his staff, they comfort us. Indeed, because of his guidance, we can live with the assurance that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And through the sons of Korah, God tells us that he is an ever-present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we don't have any reason to fear, even though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, even though the ocean waters roar and foam and the mountains tremble because of their surging. God is with us. He promises that. And today, as we begin or continue walking through the valley of the shadow of death, he urges us, invites us to come and seek his aid. One of the ways that we experience God's presence is through his word, what he tells us here today. The first message that God gives us is that Alan's story is not done. Death is not the end, and he is now where he has wanted to be for a number of years. And one of the places in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 to 5, we hear this place described. John says, "I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among his people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.' He who was seated on the throne said, 'I am making everything new.' Therefore, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." Isaiah the prophet spoke of this place in a slightly but fitting way in chapter 35, verses 3 to 6, where he encourages God's people to strengthen the feeble hands, steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, "Be strong, do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. Then the eyes of the blind will be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame will leap like a deer, and the mute tongue will shout for joy." Alan's story is not done. His legs have been strengthened so he can leap like a deer. His tongue has been freed so he can shout for joy. But that's not all that God tells us today. He also tells us that Alan's presence in our lives is not done. A worldwide reunion is coming, described by the Apostle Paul in 1 Thessalonians 4. And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are living, when the Lord returns, will not meet him ahead of those who have died. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. Then, together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we all will be with the Lord forever. So encourage one another with these words. On that day when Jesus descends from heaven, we believe that Alan will be one of those following in his train, rising from his grave to be reunited for all eternity with our Lord and Savior and with all the saints who have gone before him and all the saints who come after him. We can face this day with the assurance that these two statements are statements of truth because of what Jesus accomplished on the cross and in the grave. Paul tells us what that is in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 54 to 56, citing two Old Testament prophecies when he writes, asking and stating, death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Alan's story is not done. His presence with us is not done. All because of the great things that God has done and because of God's great love for his people. Hear these promises and know this truth this morning as we come together in this place. I'm going to invite Robert Young to come forward and sing the first song, How Great Thou Art. It's a celebration of God's greatness, his power, and his love. I see the stars. There is one aspect of God's greatness that I want to point out. It is a piece of God's character that meant a lot to Alan, a truth he loved and on which he built his life. It is this, that God is gracious and merciful and steadfast in his love. It's important for us to understand that we can believe that Alan is now at the throne of God and will be part of his family forever, not because of who Alan was, but because of whose he is. That's an important piece that I believe Alan would want all of us to remember. His salvation, his eternity, is not something he earned. It's not something anyone can earn, no matter how good we are. It is a gift given to those who know and believe what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 6, that we are not our own, but we have been bought with a price. It is a lesson beautifully taught in question and answer number 1 of the Heidelberg Catechism, a summary of the Christian faith written in the year 1563. The question is this: what is your only comfort in life and in death? And the answer that my only comfort in life and in death is that I am not my own, but belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all of my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. God's grace, his mercy, his steadfast love has embraced Alan and embraces all of those called by Christ, for whom Christ shed his blood, so that we could be now and forever members of God's kingdom. God is great in his grace, and in his mercy, and in his love. Let us pray. Father, your word, or through your word, your invitation comes to us this morning. As we remember, and as we reflect, and as we feel the sting of death, you urge us to listen to your voice. You promise that you will never leave us, that there is no valley too dark or deep that will cause you to abandon us. Your word promises that you will save us, opening our eyes, strengthening our legs, freeing our tongues. Your word promises that when your Son comes to reestablish his your kingdom here on earth, that all the saints who have gone before and who will come after will be part of that kingdom for all eternity. Your word promises us that all of these are true, because we are not our own. We now turn to listen to you speak again through your prophet Isaiah. I pray, Father, that on this day, the hope that is ours in Christ will become real and clear in such a way that our hearts will be renewed and the hope within us strengthened. Come, Heavenly Father, speak to us, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I would like to take a moment here to listen to God speak to us from Isaiah chapter 25, verses 6 to 8. On this mountain, Mount Zion, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove the disgrace of his people from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. I am and always have been a fan of holidays. Christmas and Easter and the 4th of July. I don't think I'm unique in that. But all of the holidays that we celebrate, my favorite has been Thanksgiving. It may be just my imagination, but I don't think I am unique in this either. At least not here, in this town, and in this church, where so many people's livelihoods are directly connected to the land. I remember coming here on Thanksgiving mornings and reading together passages like Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to God, bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. And I remember singing songs like, "We gather together," and "Now thank we all our God," and "Let all things now living," and "Come, ye thankful people, come." We sang together. We were surrounded by men and women, Alan and many of you here today. People who worked the land and for whom the words to those songs had a real life connection. As we looked back over the year and saw God's faithfulness, you could feel that real life connection as the people's voices all melded together to express their delight in God for another year's provision. Even in the hard years of 1980 through 85, 86. And it was to God that our praises were raised. Because those who gathered on Thanksgiving morning knew beyond a shadow of a doubt the truth that David wrote of in Psalm 65, 9-13, where he says about God, "You care for the land and water it. You enrich it abundantly. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain, for so you have ordained it. You drench its furrows and level its ridges. You soften it with showers and bless its crops. You crown the year with your bounty, and your carts overflow with abundance. The grasslands of the wilderness overflow. The hills are clothed with gladness. The meadows are covered with flocks, and the valleys are mantled with grain. They, the meadows and the flocks and the valleys and the people who work the land, shout for joy and sing." Whether we focus on those specific words or not, the truth there on Thanksgiving morning lived in the hearts of those who worshiped. The joy songs that we would sing together, inspired by looking back to God's providing, was just one thing that made Thanksgiving stand out in my mind. Another was the ways that that joy was shared with others. Hands would be shaken with special enthusiasm that morning. Stories of the harvest would be shared too. Yields and stock quality and stand. Stories of equipment breaking down and equipment being fixed. And stories about weather and commodity prices and how livestock was doing. And underneath it all was an unspoken but understood and felt delight in and thankfulness for God's providing a community to be part of. Underneath it all was an unspoken but understood delight in those friends who gathered with us on those mornings, who knew us and valued us. It was a recognized gift that became even more significant as we went home and gathered around our dinner tables and paused with our families to taste and see God's goodness revealed through what was prepared. The turkey and the dressing and the mashed potatoes and the sweet corn and the pumpkin pie or pecan pie and the applesauce cherry jello, which I especially enjoy. It was an experience of God's goodness expressed, revealed through those sitting around the table. The aroma of the food prepared brimmed with evidence of God's goodness. The voice of the one who prayed before we ate resonated with gratitude. The hands that made and served the food moved with the delight in God's providing. And the sounds of laughter, the stories echoed satisfaction in God's presence. And underneath it all, from the worship in the morning to the greeting after worship to the delights experienced around the table, flowed love. Love for God. Love that came from God. And love for those who were at the table with us. Stretching across generations, stretching across and tying us together when so often we were physically separated, living in other towns and places. even wrapping up a rebellious son who was at a strange place called Guatemala on Thanksgiving Day. I bring that up because Thanksgiving is coming. And I bring it up because this kind of table setting, a banquet table, is a picture of what God tells us waits for us. Listen again to what God says through his prophet Isaiah. On his mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all his people a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined, and he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord will wipe away tears from all faces. This is where we, God's people, are headed. It is a place, a table, in which love flows. Love for God. Love from God. Love for and from those at the table. Alan included. It is a table prepared by God for his people, those who have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, those who believe in the good news of the gospel and who confess that Jesus is Lord. Although the delights that we share at our Thanksgiving tables will come to an end and things will change, sometimes in the blink of an eye, the delights at God's banquet table will never fade away. I know this is a hard day, and it is a bitter thing that brings us together. But there is also a sweetness to it. The sweetness is this. Alan is one of those sitting around God's table. Alan is one of those whose voice is heard around God's table. There will be a time when you and his family join him at that table. I believe that because Alan knew God's faithfulness. He lived his life founded upon that. I don't know how you can be a farmer and not ground your life on that. You would go nuts because of the stress and worry if you did not hold firmly to the fact that God is gracious and merciful, steadfast in his love. Evidenced in how Alan lived his life was belief in what Jeremiah wrote in Lamentations 3. This I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. Alan knew that. He lived that. And he wanted everyone he knew to know and do that same thing. Though he showed his love in many ways, what he did to pass his faith on to the generations coming after him, what was his greatest act of love? Going to invite Robert to come and sing another song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. As you sing I invite you to think back to the ways that Alan lived his life, the ways that you saw him live his life based on faith in the truth of God's grace, mercy, and love. To remember the ways that he encouraged you to believe in God's faithfulness too, and to remember the legacy that he thus leaves. Amen. Eternally with you. We especially thank you for Alan, for the gift of his life, for the grace that you have given him, for all that was good and kind and faithful and true in him. We thank you that for Alan, death is past, pain is ended, and he has entered the joy you have prepared in the company of all the saints. Give us faith to look beyond touch and sight, and in seeing that we are surrounded by such great a cloud of witnesses, enable us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Bring us at last to your eternal peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. And now, into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Alan. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, as we go from this place, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up the light of his presence upon you and fill you with his peace. Amen.